A very good morning to all my dear students and listeners as well. Before starting with today's topic, I just want to apprise you that this topic has an interconnection with another topic, that is temporary injunctions, and it has also resemblance with mandatory injunction. As such, in the light of the law pertaining to temporary and mandatory injunction, we have to read the law of permanent injunction, which would be helpful in drafting an application, in drafting a suit for permanent injunction under the subject captioned as drafting, pleading and convincing. As you all are aware that this particular falls or is provided under unit 2 of the university syllabus, that is GGS IPU. As such, before starting with the today's topic, I just want to recapitulate the law laid down pertaining to permanent injunctions as well as temporary injunctions for the better understanding and thereby to develop the skills for drafting a suit for permanent injunction. So, my dear students, let's start with the law laid down first with regard to temporary and permanent injunction. As far as the law relating to injunctions are concerned, it is submitted that injunction is a court order that requires a person to do or to abstain from doing an act that is necessary in terms of justice, and the absence of which would be contrary to good faith and good conscience. Further, basically, the grant of an injunction aims to restore the violated rights of a party, whereby monetary or compensated damages are insufficient. It follows the principles of natural justice and equity. The granting of an injunction is a relative one. Basically, the approval for an injunction would vary from case to case and situation to situation and depends at the discretion of the court. There are primarily two kinds of injunctions, and these are temporary injunctions and permanent injunctions. A temporary injunction is a provisional relief that aims to protect the subject matter of the in the existing condition without the defendant interference or threat. Further, it aims to protect the plaintiff from getting disposed of or his property being destroyed or harmed, and thereby to protect his property till the pendency of the suit, that is pendente lite. The primary reason behind a temporary injunction is to protect the interest of an individual or an entity till the final judgment is pronounced. A temporary injunction, when granted, continues to remain for a specified period of time or till the court deems fit. When can a temporary injunction be granted? Whether the plaintiff has a prima facie case? So, my dear student, I am right now providing you the test for on the basis of which a temporary injunction may be filed in a court of law. And these are: whether the plaintiff has a prima facie case in his favor. Second, whether the balance of convenience is there in favor of the plaintiff, and whether the plaintiff would suffer irreparable loss if the injunction is not granted. So this is about temporary injunction. Now I just want to explain you what is a permanent injunction. As far as a permanent injunction is concerned, it is also known as perpetual injunction. It is one that is delivered at the time of the final judgment in a decree or in a civil suit by way of a decree, and therefore is more often than not prevalent for a longer period of time. In this scenario, the defendant is perpetually restrained from the commission of an act, or the abstinence from the commission of an act which would defeat the interest of the plaintiff. Further, Section 38 of the Specific Relief Act provides the situation where permanent injunction can be granted. So, my dear student, for drafting a suit for permanent injunction, one must have a thorough knowledge about Section 38 given under the Specific Relief Act. And Section 38 provides that, subject to the other provisions contained in or referred by this chapter, a perpetual injunction may be granted to the plaintiff, thereby to prevent the breach of an obligation existing in his favor, whether expressly or by implication. Secondly, when any such obligation arises from contract, the court shall be guided by the rules and the provisions in Chapter 2. Thirdly, when the defendant invades or threatens to invade the plaintiff's right or enjoyment of property, the court may grant a perpetual injunction in the following cases. So, my dear students, while drafting a suit, following points must be adhered to or must be put in the drafting of the civil suit pertaining to the permanent injunction. And these points are: when the defendant invades or threatens to invade, or when the defendant is the trustee of the property for the plaintiff. So, in this circumstance, you may file a permanent injunction. Second, where there exists no standard for ascertaining the actual damage caused or likely to be caused by the invasion of the defendant. And third, where the invasion is such that the compensation in money would not afford adequate relief, meaning thereby, where there is a monetary compensation is inadequate, then in those cases, the court would not grant a decree of permanent injunction in favor of the plaintiff and against the defendant. Further, this permanent injunction suit can be granted in order to prevent a multiplicity of judicial proceedings, meaning thereby, it will not tantamount to multiplicity of judicial proceedings. To simplify this point, let us use some illustrations. Ram is a tenant at Shyam's flat. Shyam has specifically asked Ram not to displace the prayers room as it had a gold statue of a deity. Ram willfully disobeyed and tried to remove the statue. Here the court may grant a permanent injunction in order for Ram to fulfill the request of Shyam. So, my dear students, please bear all these points while drafting a civil suit. Now, I will provide you the format for filing a civil suit for permanent injunction. As you all are aware that at the threshold, you have to mention the name of the judge as well as his designation and the place of the court. So the same may be put in as in the court of civil judge or ADJ or high court as the case may be. So and so court. Here I have given the example of Teeshajari courts, Delhi. Civil suit number. You have to mention thereafter the suit number. The civil suit number you may mention and the year in which that civil suit has been instituted. Here I have given the year as 2008. Thereafter you have to explain the parties. So in this particular format, I have given the name of the parties as Mr. X, the plaintiff, versus Mr. Y, the defendant. Thereafter you have to give the title to the suit. So here I have given the title as suit for permanent, prohibitory and mandatory injunction, restraining the defendant from raising any construction over the suit land comprising in khata number so and so, khasra number so and so, biswa number so and so, situated at so and so. Restraining the defendant from causing any construction over the suit land against the Municipal Corporation Act and bylaws and Town and Country Planning Act and rules, and also directing the defendant to remove illegal and unauthorized construction over the suit land owned and possessed by the plaintiff, and also directing the demolition of the construction already raised or raised during the pendency of the suit on the setback area of the suit land owned by defendant, and also with the prayer to direct the defendant to hand over the peaceful possession of the suit land already encroached upon by the defendant number so and so. So my dear student, this is the title of the suit. Thereafter, you may put it as that the plaintiff is the owner in possession of land comprising number so and so, khata number so and so, khevat number so and so, katoni number so and so, measuring so and so, situated at there. Mean you have to explain the possession of the plaintiff as the and details of the property you may mention in the first paragraph. Thereafter, similarly, you have to apprise about the defendant and explain his possession with regard to the suit property. Third, that a defendant number one during the month of so and so has started raising further construction in as much without leaving any setback as prescribed by the law, and further encroached upon the land of the plaintiff by projecting the chhachas towards the land of the plaintiff, and thus obstructing light, air and sun to the building of the plaintiff, besides causing nuisance to the plaintiff and his tenants, thereby depriving the plaintiff of his easementary right of light, air and sun, which rights were being enjoyed by the plaintiff and his predecessor in interest from time immemorial, peacefully, openly and hostile to the very knowledge of the defendant or other persons living in the vicinity. The said rights of the easementary have now been infringed by the defendant in the month of so and so by raising the construction in the haphazard manner in as much as the defendant number one. Thereafter, you may mention that the cause of action accrued to the plaintiff on so and so date, and you may narrate those facts herein, and the same is still continuing and subsisting. Thereafter, that the plaintiff is permanently residing within the jurisdiction of this honorable court, and all the correspondence from the defendant were received at his home address, and the office of the defendant is located in the territory of this honorable court, and hence this court has each and every jurisdiction to try and entertain this suit. Thereafter, you have to mention or apprise the court about the valuation of the suit for the purpose of jurisdiction, and which para you may write it as that the value of the suit for the purpose of the jurisdiction has been fixed for ₹200, and for the purpose of declaration and correct and authorized court fees of rupees so and so has been affixed on the plain. Thereafter, you may mention that no suit has been instituted against the defendant on the same or similar cause in any court, including High Court and Supreme Court, whereby you may allege that this is not a second suit which is barred by the principles of either of Section 11 CPC, that is Res Judicata, or a 2 Rule 2 CPC, as the case may be. in the end you have to give mention the prayer, or you have to pray before the honorable court, and the prayer in with regard to suit for permanent injunction may be written as under. It is respectfully prayed to this honorable court that it decree for permanent prohibitory injunction and mandatory injunction restraining the defendant from raising any construction over the suit land comprising in khata number so and so, khatoni number so and so, khasa number so and so, piswa number so and so, restraining the defendant from causing any construction over the suit land and against the Municipal Corporation Act and Bylaw and Town and Country Planning Act and Rules, and also directing the defendant to remove illegal and unauthorized construction over the suit land owned and possessed by the plaintiff, and also directing the demolition of the construction already raised on the setback area of the suit land owned by the defendant, and also with the prayer to direct the defendant to hand over the peaceful possession of the suit land already encroached upon by the defendant number one be passed in favor of the plaintiff and against the defendant with the cost of the suit. Further, you may pray before the court that it may give you pass any other relief as it deem fit and proper in the facts and circumstances of the case, which may be passed in favor of plaintiff and against the defendant in the interest of justice. So these all are the points which may be put, which needs to be mentioned and are taken care of while drafting a suit for permanent injunction. Thereafter, you may put or pray before the court as also like this: and for this act of kindness, the humbly plaintiff, as in bound, duty bound, shall ever pray. Thereafter, the plaint needs to be sent by the plaintiff and also by his advocate, and you may mention the place of the signing. Here, the person or the plaintiff signs at Delhi. Further, the suit must also have a verification as well, thereby to comply with the provisions of Order 6, Rule 14 and 15 of CPC, wherein you mentioned that I do hereby verify that the contents of the above plaint from para number so and so to so and so are true and correct to the best of my knowledge and belief, and this needs to be verified at Delhi on this day of this month of so and so, and thereafter it needs to be signed by the plaintiff. So my dear students, this is all about today's lecture. Hope you have learnt a lot from it. In case of any query, then you may write it to me at my email ID, that is rahularoda.gr@jagannath.org. But before parting with today's lecture, I just want to apprise you with my new topic which I am going to take in my next class, and my next lecture would be on drafting of suit for dissolution of partnership. Thank you very much. We'll meet you soon in my next lecture. Stay home, stay safe, and stay healthy. Thank you very much again.